Okay, I guess you can see from this, right, that I'm not trying to be the next Sim Wong Hoo, but I'm not trying to be him. Because if for those who don't know who Sim Wong Hoo is, right, he's actually a Singaporean founder of this company called Creative Technology. So he created this company to make this product called a Sound Blaster sound card. So, but I'm not near his level, lah. So, but this is just my effort in trying to create something like a sound card, yeah, that we something that we take for granted today. So, before I begin, right, I would like to start with the demo first. Okay. So, So you can see, right, on my computer sound card, right, I've muted it, lah, so that to make sure that whatever sound that comes out, right, is actually from the sound card I have here, which is connected to my machine. Okay. Let me close this. Eh, what happened? Can get on the. Sorry.
Try again.
Okay. Okay. So let me now play a soundtrack here. So okay, sorry, let me type password.
Just show us the password.
Wait, sorry, why?
Don't resist.
Okay, can.
Yo,
okay.
Christopher,
Okay, the song is not that bad, right? I think if y'all know what this music is, it's called Blue, lah. It's quite an old song. Okay, I just let it play for a few more seconds. Okay, then, I'll just show you the system resource usage. You can see my computer CPU on one of the core is 100%, which I'll explain later why is this the case. Okay. Then also notice some of the frame skip, which I always also explain later what those mean. Okay, so now I'll just stop it. Okay, now let me go back to my slides. Okay, thanks. Okay, sorry. Okay, so a brief background. Actually, this sound card is quite... I created this sound card a few months back for this talk. I gave a Hackware. So I gave this talk September last year about installing Windows 3.1 on a modern machine. Okay, so the modern machine, right, it does not have sound card that can work with such an old operating system. So I actually created this Covox sound card, which is based on an old design, and Windows 3.1 has drivers for it. So that's why... I decided that why not I give a more specific talk today about this sound card. So now I pass around this sample. Just pass behind. Okay, so what is this Covox Speech Thing? So okay, this sound card was released in 1986, and it's only 8-bit mono. So you can see from this audio connector here, right, there are only two connections. So for a stereo audio connector, there are actually 3 points, but there are only 2 points here, which means this is actually a mono connection. Okay? And it uses the parallel port interface here. Because such an old sound card, right? So there's no USB at that time. USB only came out in 1996. So this is actually a legacy connector. Okay? So I understand that not everyone of you know what a parallel port is. So I have just a brief introduction. So a parallel port, right, is actually a very old port. So it came out in 1970. The original use was for printers. So but this Centronics company actually made printers. So you can see these are parallel pin connections, but for the purposes of my sound card, right, I only use these 8 data pins here. Okay. Then yeah, so they use it for printers, zip drives, and CNC machines. Okay. Then obviously we don't see a parallel port today because the parallel port has been replaced by USB. Okay. So how does this Covox Speech Thing works? Okay. So a Covox Speech Thing is actually made up of an R2R resistor ladder. So this name R2R comes from the fact that there are two sets of resistors here. So this set of resistors here, these are all 10k ohms. And another set of resistors here, they are 20k ohms, so double of this. So they call this R2R resistor ladder. Okay, so this is also called 8-bit digital to analog converter, or DAC for short. So how does this work is that there are 8 data lines in the parallel port, and each of them is connected here. Okay, so each of these data outputs, right, it contributes a small voltage to the final output here. Okay, so the most significant bit, right, is actually the last one, data 7 here. So you can see, right, whatever goes in, almost all of it goes to the final output. But for the other data outputs, right, not so much. So for example, the data zero, the signal that goes through here, right, it needs to pass through here and go through all the other 10K resistors. So by the time it reaches here, right, the current is not so much already. So it doesn't contribute as much to the final output. Okay, next. Okay, then another issue is that to use a Covox or to use a resistor ladder, right, you need a very precise resistor values in the order of less than 1%. This is because, right, if let's say you use something higher tolerance, 5%, right, the increased tolerance of the resistors over here, right, can overwhelm the values over here. So, but for in my sound card, I use 0.5%. Because the price difference between 0.5% and 1% is quite close. Okay, then the next thing is that on my sound card, I also have an amplifier. Because the R2R resistor, they don't give a very high output, so I need to amplify the sound. Okay, so the amplifier chip I use is called LM386 by Texas Instruments. Okay, so I have three settings on my sound card. So, three ways to change the volume, gain, and bass. So I use it through the three potential. I adjust through the three potentiometers. You can see, if you see the sound card that I'm passing around now. Okay. So how do I adjust the volume? Just use a voltage divider here to bring up and down the volume. Then the gain, right? The gain actually is adjusted by this amplifier. So what the data sheet specifies is that you just connect a resistor capacitor circuit between the gain pins. So the gain is here, gain 1 and gain 8 pins here. I just connect a RC circuit between these two and just adjust it. For the bass, the data sheet also says you connect RC circuit between pin 1 and the output. So RC bass is here, V out is here, and the gain 1. So just you can put an adjustable resistor here. Okay. So how do typical sound cards get data? So obviously the Covox speech thing is not a typical sound card. But I'd like to explain first how the usual sound cards work. So there's this technology called direct memory access. Okay. So you can see, right, this is a typical layout in your computer's motherboard. Okay, so you have a CPU, the PCI Express root complex here, the RAM, and then your peripheral devices. So I just maybe have one audio device and a network device. Okay, so direct memory access means that this PCIe device, right, can directly access the RAM without needing to involve the CPU in the process. Okay, and in every peripheral, there's a component called the DMA engine. Okay, so we'll see what is it about later. So let's say the CPU wants to transfer some data over to this audio device. Okay, so what the CPU usually does, it first has to load it into RAM first. The second one is that the CPU will then tell this particular DMA engine the memory addresses of the data that this guy needs to fetch from here. Okay, then after that, the CPU will tell this chip that, okay, now you can start fetching from RAM. And then once it does so, right, the CPU can do other things. And the device itself will handle the actual transfer. Then once the transfer is done, then the device will inform the CPU that, okay, the transfer is complete. Okay, so the CPU is basically is free to do other things while the memory intensive and the heavy process transferring is done by the device. The problem is on the Covox speech thing, right, you only have a bunch of resistors. It does not have a DMA engine. So there is no choice. The CPU has to be involved in transferring all the data manually, micromanaging the transfer over to the device. Okay. So this is my implementation. I actually cloned the Covox speech thing. I tried to find one online. I couldn't find one. Yeah, apparently it's quite rare these days. Okay, so I'll pass down another one more. So this is actually my initial prototype without the amplifier. Okay, I just pass this. Okay. Raw. And then my device also has two audio output jacks. So one of them is the raw output. In case that for some reason you don't want to use the amplifier, you have your own amplifier, then you can just use that. Otherwise, there's an amplified output which comes out from the LM386 output. Okay, so how do I send data to the Covox speech thing? Obviously, modern computers don't have parabots these days, right? So I had to use a native parabot adapter. So the one I use, right, is this one. So this is actually an express card to parabot adapter. Okay, an express card is basically a PCI Express for laptops. Okay, Then on if you have a desktop, then you can use this one, a PCI Express to serial or parallel. I use this at home also, it works also. Just a keynote of caution, right? You can't use USB parallel adapters. This is because right, they abstract out the pin handling. You don't have direct access to each of the 8 pins. Yeah, to the computer, it appears as a USB printer, not as a USB parallel board. Okay, so another thing is about ensuring consistent data send rate. So a typical CD quality is this, yeah, 60 bits per sample. You have two channels, one for the left and one for the right, and a sampling rate of 44,100 hertz. So this actually has a key implication because, let's take a look, in order to play 44,100 samples per second, you need to play them, each sample has to be played within 22.68 microseconds. And you cannot deviate too far from this, because if you deviate too far from this, right, audio will be distorted. So on a modern modern computers, right, it's actually very difficult to achieve this. It's easy to do this. It's easy to do this on a microcontroller, but for a microprocessor, it's tough lah. Okay, so I decided to look around. So actually, I found someone actually wrote this DOS media player. So this guy actually released it quite recently, 2007. Okay, so he actually replaced the DOS interrupt service routine. So interrupt service routine is something like a timer. You can tell the CPU like, please give me a certain timing. But the problem is it only has 55 milliseconds, which is nowhere near 22 microseconds. So what this guy did, right, is that he actually replaced the ISR for DOS, this program. It's possible to do this because DOS is actually quite low level, single tasking. The application has full access to the entire computer's resources. But this is not the case for modern Windows and Linux operating systems. Okay, so I decided to try out whether is it possible or not. So I wrote my own player, which you all saw just now. Okay, so I wrote it for the Linux platform, but there is no technical limitation on why this cannot run on Windows 10 also. Okay, so what my program needs is just a music file and the address to the parallel port. So just for completeness, I just show how to get the address. So you can just use this command lspci-v. So you notice that here, this is actually my parallel port adapter. You just need to find the address here. So IO ports at 3008. So this is the address. Another way is, this one. Yeah, so I just filter, then you can see here. This is one of the addresses here, 3008. So you just need to supply this to my program. And you can write to that particular address. Okay. Okay. The entire application is written in C for maximum performance. So of course, I really usually try to avoid writing in C lah. But this is no choice because I need maximum performance. I need to have a very tight while loop. And another thing is that a lot of the API calls are in C, so it's there's no real point to write it in another higher level language. Okay. So I also print out the frame skip number, which you all saw here, just now. So what this means is that those that cannot be played, because in the while loop, right, in the next iteration of the loop, it's already past certain frames. It's basically skipped, right? It's unable to play because of the, scheduling. Because my program is not the only thing running, so the Linux will interrupt my program regular intervals to run other stuff. So during that moment, right, it's unable to play the frames. Okay, so the workflow. So I actually use the help of FFmpeg to convert the file to WAV if it's not a WAV already. Then actually I also use this library called libsoundfile to pass the WAV file for me because it has a lot of things like headers, everything. I don't want to care so much about it. I just need the audio data. Then I convert every frame to 1 byte because recall that the Covox Speech Thing only has 8 data lines. So it only has, you can only accept 1 byte samples. So and typical music files have 16 bits. In sample, so I convert it. Then I'll just directly write it to the parallel port. Then go back to step 3 until the music file finishes. Okay. So to ensure a consistent playback, so what I do is that I calculate the time required to play each frame first. So I just take this nanoseconds, 1E9 divided by the number of sample rate. I can know how long it takes, how long is required to play per frame. Then I run it in a very tight while loop here. Okay, so in every while loop, right, every iteration of the loop, I'll get the current system nanoseconds. So in Linux, they have this API to get the current system time in nanoseconds. So it's possible to do it. So I just keep looping until the nanosecond has been reached, 22 microseconds has passed, then I play the next frame. Okay? So the I have actually some future work, potential work here. So actually I did create a USB version, but I didn't have time to test this. So the USB version, how is it differs from the previous one is that it has this FTDI chip, FT245R, USB to 8 channel output here. So technically, right, you can use it as a USB sound card. Covox as a USB sound card. But yeah, I didn't have time to write it because the way that this chip works is that it exposes itself as a serial port. So you can't use a native serial port because it's not fast enough for this particular, it's not precise enough. So you need to use FTDI's drivers and libraries to write it in a consistent way, which I didn't have time to do. So anyway, this thing is bought as open source. So if you want to try it, yeah, up to you. Okay, so I called this project a science project. So why did I call it that? Okay, so actually I have to credit to this guy. So this guy is called Raymond Chen. He's a software engineer at Microsoft. So he writes this blog, it's called The Old New Thing, where he discusses about Microsoft projects and why the reason why Windows does things in a certain way. So in one of his blog posts, he's talked about a science project. As long as it meets one of these categories, yeah, it's considered a science project. So the first category is a feature that's really cool and challenging, but it's overkill. The second one is that it requires hardware that few people have. And the third category is you try to solve a problem that nobody really considers to be a problem. You're just doing it for the gimmick factor. So I like to think that my project has maybe met these two criteria. Because how many people have parapods these days? And another thing is that, why is this really a problem now that you have modern sound card hardware in your computer? So yeah. Okay, so yeah, that's the end. So I have two more minutes, right? Okay, so, okay, another issue I want to talk about. So I actually have this docking station with me. So this is a docking station obviously meant for this laptop. It has a native paraport. And we also recall that I talked about Windows 3.1 and DOS, right? It's also, this is also the same machine that I used for that. So maybe after the end of Hackware, right, maybe some of you can help me. I'm trying to get it to work on this paraport using the old DOS programs. Okay, how much do I have? 135, maybe. Okay, you have a question? Yeah,
have you tried FreeDOS?
FreeDOS, no, I've not tried, yeah.
Because they just released a new version of FreeDOS.
Okay.
And one of the things that people use FreeDOS for is specifically that you have no barrier between you and direct access to your parallel port or any other
part. Okay, good. I'll give it a try. Okay, one more minute. Okay, take one last question. Okay, then that's all then. Yeah.